So Hive Society, I'm here with two of the band members. We've got Finn McAllister and we've got Richie Saluga and two other band members as well. Maybe you guys can mention them.
Jasper Harrison, who's behind
just off stage.
And Noah Haynes is who's, the other guy, who's the drummer.
Who's the drummer.
He's yeah. in Kent, I think.
And this is, we're going to be talking about your band. We're going to be talking about an event on Friday as well, about a new record label and also about Save Our Music venue. So we've got a lot to get through. So start off with the Hive Society. What's behind the name there? Maybe Rishi would start with you.
So basically we were thinking about concepts like groupthink and like people thinking the same thing as the next person and not sort of having their own individual thought. So that's kind of, yeah, where Hive Society, the name came from. But that sort of concept isn't like overt in our lyrics. It's more of just an idea that we liked. So that's where that comes from.
Yeah. Finn, tell us a bit about the group and how did you get started? Because I know that Rishi met Jasper, didn't you, at Manchester University?
Yeah, so...
Finn, you're kind of almost Brighton-born and bred, aren't you?
Almost Brighton-born and bred.
And there's a Liverpool connection as well.
A little Liverpool connection, yeah. But mainly Brighton-born and bred. I actually can't claim to have been in the band from the start. Jasper and Rish founded Hive Society when they were in Manchester. And then I joined... kind of September time, unfortunately after they'd played Glastonbury, so yeah. I didn't get to I don't get to claim I played Glastonbury, but hopefully next year.
And what's your music like then? I know we're going to be listening to one of the songs, first half, second one, and
so it's sort of psychedelic indie music. We kind of take influence from bands like Unknown Mortal Orchestra, bands like Crumb and Men I Trust, so sort of dreamlike sort of psychedelic stuff. But we also bring in dancey elements as well, like Finn's influenced by quite a lot of electronic music, so we've kind of brought that into the single a bit as well, so just taking influence from a lot of different places.
We try not to let it be too boxed into any one genre. We've all got such a kind of broad range of tastes that we don't really want to just be another indie band.
Should we take a listen?
Absolutely.
Sure.
Yep.
So that's the exchange. So what's the thought process behind that then? Because it sounds a bit mystic.
Maybe
it's Bifred or something.
So I don't know. There's kind of a lot of things in there. We recorded it. It's the first thing we've ever recorded as a band, and it was recorded entirely through lockdown, kind of over Zoom and things like that. And so the track changed quite a lot during that process. It's probably a very different tune to one that would have been produced under normal circumstances if we'd just gone into a studio and recorded it normally. I think the amount of time we had to record it meant
it was a positive.
Yeah, it was a positive, and it means that it changed quite a lot from kind of how we first imagined it.
And I think because it is our first release, it was good that that was the process, because it meant that, you know, it gave us time to kind of define our own sound, because we were kind of thinking after we did a tour in February just before lockdown, and we thought, okay, like maybe we should just go into a studio and get it, you know, record it kind of live as we played it and get that down. But then I think looking back at how we were playing the songs on tour to like what they've become, they've evolved so much, and that's because we had sort of 8 weeks of lockdown, or even more than that, but sort of 8 weeks of recording just two songs, you know, just revising things and just taking our time.
And who do you all take part in that writing process then?
So we've all kind of chipped in with the writing, like these songs. The Exchange like was written in Manchester, and then Warped was kind of like an idea that started like last summer for me in Bristol, and then showed these guys it, and then it became something completely
kind
new.
It's nice
that, you know, I listened back to the demo of that like first recording with just guitar, and then to what it's become now is like completely different, but in a good way.
A bit more about the record label. I know you're looking to, you've got an event coming up on Friday.
Yes.
And it's so, you're going to be hosting it yourself.
Yeah,
with some other band taking part as well.
Yes, exactly. So Air Driver Records is our brand new label that we're starting up. Initially to release our own music, but the idea is we want to kind of create a bit of a hub in Brighton for creatives, and we want to be involved with kind of anyone who inspires us.
Yeah, and that's not kind of limited to, you know, musicians as well. Like, we want to work with artists and, you know, videographers and people that are just interested in creating interesting things.
There's such a wealth of talent in Brighton. It's such a kind of melting pot of creative talent. And we just thought it would be, rather than just releasing our own music, we thought we'd love to kind of be working with all kinds of artists. Mm.
You guys are quite young, so you're doing quite a lot fairly early, which is great. So how do you go about setting up a record label? I mean, how?
Well, that's a good question.
You know, you can set up, we're going to get to the stage, obviously, setting up a company and stuff, but, you know, when you're starting out, it's just a matter of, you know, creating it and like creating the branding for it and et cetera, which is what we've done. But we are managing like all aspects of the label and the band. So there's a lot of work and, you know, it's a learning process as well, but it is rewarding.
We've signed a distribution deal with a company called State 51. So they're going to be taking care of all of our distributing to companies like Spotify and Apple Music and things like that. And they're also creating a lot of kind of creative assets for us. Like, they're doing a lot of creative work behind the scenes, helping us out with that stuff. So that's really helpful, and hopefully something that we can offer to other artists working with us.
Yeah, because there's a lot in Brighton, aren't there? Some of them have played it here at Latest Music Bar, and I know that this gig is for the Hope and Ruin.
Exactly.
Which is another great music venue. Yeah. So what's going on Friday then?
Well, as we are creating something brand new in Brighton, we didn't want it really to be just about us, because there's so much going on right now. We felt like we couldn't really create this label and just focus on ourselves and try and put out our own music. So we were trying to think of ways that we could actually be involved in the local music community. And obviously the Hope and Ruin has just been, well, for Jasper and I, at least growing up in Brighton, it's just such a massively inspirational venue, like the Hope as it was in kind of years gone by. Obviously, coronavirus has just destroyed the live music scene, and venues across the country are just, you know, couldn't really be worse for them. Their income has just been just decimated. Disappeared overnight. Yeah. And so we just thought it's a brilliant way of hopefully offering something back to the kind of community that we've grown up in would be to try and help Hope and Ruin out a bit. So the live stream and launch is in collaboration with Save Our Venues, which is an initiative raising money for venues across the country.
Yeah.
And so during the live stream, people will be invited to donate via a GoFundMe page.
Yeah.
To kind of just help raise some money for the Hope and Ruin to keep them floating.
Mm, yeah.
What time's that kick off then? What's the start time?
So that's 6:30.
6:30 till?
Around 8:30.
And what can we hear? So we're going to hear, it's going to be your music, isn't it?
Yes.
There's a band called Gene Pool, who are locals, and they've actually played here as well.
Latest Music Bar, yeah.
And Cousin, so they're like a duo, like electronic dance music duo.
Yeah.
And then
they've played with Fatboy Slim, haven't they?
Yeah. So they're doing really well, and they've also been played a lot by Annie Mac on BBC on Radio 1. And then Juno Dreams, the other act as well. So
Juno Dream, our headliners, they're actually Bristol-based, but are very, very kindly said they'd like to be involved in helping out the Hope and Ruin, which is nice of them. And they're doing really well. Their track To the Moon has
got a few million streams.
Jackson today, who are kind of saying how much they love that tune. So it's really, really great to have them on board. Mm. We think it's going to be a great night. Virtually.
So that's going to be that's Friday then, 6:30 p.m. kickoff. How do we find out about it? How do we log on and listen in?
Well, there's an event, a Facebook event, which has all the information. If you want to access it via the Air Driver Facebook, you can see it on our events. Or if you can't be bothered to do that, then just get on the Hope and Ruins Facebook, Hope and Ruin Brighton.
Yeah.
6:30 on Friday night, and it'll be, hopefully, as long as there isn't a massive technical...
Yeah.
Because things can go wrong. Things can go wrong.
Yeah, things can go wrong, can't they? But I'm sure it's going to be fine for Friday. And do you, just before we finish up in the first half, do you think that's the future for the time being, then, Zooming?
I think
concerts, Zooming events, and then maybe moving to, like, partially populated venues, yeah, but still a bit of streaming, live streaming?
I think for now, like, you know, this is our first event, and in the future we want to, like, we want to put on events, nights, like, in Brighton, yeah, at a venue, but for now it's kind of, yeah, got to see when that's able, yeah, to do that.
All right, and join us for the second half. We'll be speaking to Rishi and Finn a bit more about their music, Glastonbury, and also the Save Our Venues campaign. So I'm back here with Rishi and with Finn, and we're talking about the Hive Society, we're talking about Skydriver Records, but we're also talking about
Glastonbury. Airdriver.
Airdriver. Skydriver's
yeah, great, Skydriver.
That's a good one, actually, yeah. So, Glastonbury, when did you play there then? I know obviously there's different stages.
Yeah, so I basically played there as, like, a solo artist, like, in 2017. And that was through basically a mate in Bristol who was also a musician, yeah, knew someone who ran a stage. So it's kind of, you know, through knowing someone who knows someone. And it was a very, like, independent small stage, you know, like, it wasn't on one of the BBC stages or anything. And basically, yeah, so played there in 2017, and then obviously still had that contact, and then when me and Jasper formed the band, it was obviously around October time, November, and I sort of thought, okay, well, might as well get in contact with him, and in the end he said, yeah, you know, you guys can have a slot. And so then that's kind of how the band started. It was kind of, we, yeah, were working towards this, our first gig, which was Glastonbury, which is quite a good motivator, because, yeah, like, we knew we had to have 8 songs, like, recorded, written to a standard, like, that we could play them live, and it would be good. So, yeah, so that's how that happened. And then in the end, we did 2 sets there. We played on the Friday and the Saturday, and obviously, like, it was really hot. So we were playing in a tent, so a lot of people came in just for shade, and it was near a food market as well. So, like, there was people sort of walking. There was a lot of passing traffic. So,
did
really
you get
good.
To meet any other people there? Big band?
Not other big bands.
It's kind of separated a bit.
Exactly, yeah. I mean, we were playing on a very small stage. I remember we could actually see, like, the tip of the pyramid stage from where we were playing. So it was kind of like, you know, from here to there, could see where we were, yeah, where we're aiming for.
Sure.
But yeah, obviously it was great. Like, there was a nice little community of people running that stage who I think, you know, do it a lot and have done Glastonbury for a lot of years. So it was great, yeah, to kind of, like, chat to them, and they're all just, like, really great guys and girls.
When did you get involved in Finn, after Glastonbury?
Well, I was at uni in Leeds.
And so in terms of, so after Glastonbury, you kind of, that's where you formalised the,
yeah,
you kind of got your material and edited it down in a way.
Yeah, yeah, and you know, like, written a few new songs as well, and just kind of got our live set as a 4-piece down, because when we played Glastonbury, we played as a 3-piece with the drummer.
Yeah.
So yeah, we kind of refined it and then started kind of gigging. One of our first gigs was actually at Latest here.
Yeah.
What
year was that?
That was last year.
Last year.
The end in, like, November,
yeah,
time, I think. And then we kind of thought, okay, well, we've done a few gigs now, but again, it was kind of, let's set ourselves a big goal.
It feels like it's always been like, we'll set ourselves a goal, mm, we'll work towards.
Yeah.
Rather than kind of just floating around, yeah, aimlessly. So you had Glasto first.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Then we were doing a live session. Then we had a tour booked in for February. Mm. So there's always been something that we're...
And you've done the tour, haven't you?
Yeah, we got that in just before...
lockdown.
Thankfully, just before lockdown. So, yeah, I was obviously completely unaware, yeah, of what was
so
coming.
So where were you playing for that tour then?
Where
did that take you?
Brighton, a Green Door store. We did Bristol, Leeds, Manchester and London and Portsmouth as well. Yeah.
Right. Who books all that? Who does all the...
We did it all.
You all do that?
Yeah, yeah.
We do everything. Right.
We've done everything, which is, like... That was really rewarding, actually, like, the fact that we'd organised it ourselves. But it was also very difficult because, obviously, if you have a booking agent, you know, trying to get the gigs consecutively was the hardest part.
It's an absolute nightmare.
You know, because, like, having a booking agent, yeah, can do that for you, yeah, and, like, yeah, has the contacts, but we were just kind of just thinking, okay, well, they've said they can do that and they've said that they can't do that day. So we had to kind of organise
it. Labour of love.
Yeah. And because you guys work, I know Jasper and everyone, you guys do full-time jobs almost as well, don't you?
So unfortunately, at this point, we're not making quite enough through AirDriver to live off it, but hopefully.
Mm. Yeah.
I don't know, a couple of months' time. SkyDriver, let's see how that goes.
So this is going to be, how do you get yourself established then? What normally happens with a band? How do they get to that next level?
I mean,
a bit of luck involved.
Well,
in that,
there's a bit of luck, but it is, I think it's making your own luck. And I think the thing that the sort of ethos that we've said to ourselves is that we're not going to kind of, you know, run around trying to find industry people and go, you know, like, please give us a shot. Please give us a chance. Like, we're going to kind of do it ourselves. And this is why we've created this label. And, you know, just we're going to try and do that all ourselves.
We'll let people come to us.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. Good fun, yeah. So we've got Warped.
Yes.
That's the second song, isn't it, that you've recorded?
It's the double A. It's the flip side of the double A side single, if you will.
Tell us a bit about Warped a minute. We'll take a listen then.
So it's a much more kind of down-tempo tune, kind of the antithesis of The Exchange.
I think it shows like another side to our songwriting. That's why we kind of wanted to have that one in there. We were also very excited about it because it was the first one that we'd kind of written as a three together.
Yeah.
So we were like, okay, this is quite representative of the sound that we want. But then we also had this kind of faster, fuller sounding, just kind of more upbeat song.
Yeah.
So hopefully it shows like a breadth of our sound.
Yeah, I'm going to take a listen. So that's Warped. So with that then, you've had that professionally recorded, haven't you? So, I mean, how did you get that all organised?
Well, it was professionally recorded and we did it ourselves.
Yeah.
So,
I'm glad you think it sounds professional.
Yeah. It actually was completely unprofessionally recorded just in our bedrooms. But we did it entirely through lockdown.
I think, like, we've got, you know, We do have the knowledge of like how to record and stuff like.
Well, we've both been producing stuff for years.
Yeah, yeah. So like we've, you know, and like different sort of skills as well, like that we kind of mixed together in terms of production. And then just like I was saying, it did take a lot of, you know, reflective listening and like having a break from it and then coming back to it and going, okay, how can we tweak it? But we got there in the end, basically just recording it all from lockdown.
And how did you find that process? Because we do a regular jazz show and I speak to a lady called Imogen Ryle. She's been doing a lot of gigs through lockdown. Actually, one of them she did, someone was based in America. So you kind of get to listen to people live, obviously via Zoom, which you wouldn't do normally if you're at a live music venue. So there is some benefits.
I think it's something that we've definitely noticed is that kind of from a business point of view, from an AirDriver point of view, there are silver linings to the situation, you know, the coronavirus situation, because obviously, you know, it's completely awful and it's absolutely kind of destroyed plenty of people, millions of people's lives. But it does mean it's given us the opportunity to kind of be really reflective about the recording process and also for AirDriver potentially to work with people who we wouldn't normally get to work with.
Yeah, on like a first event.
Yeah, you know? For example, Hope and Ruin, a massive venue, but who, you know, we're just starting out, so we might struggle to kind of work with them on our launch under normal circumstances. But I think because of how weird the situation is right now for everything, I think kind of the rules have kind of gone out the window a little bit, and there are opportunities there that maybe wouldn't be there in under normal circumstances.
So, say if I'm our venues, then I know that that's the gig on Friday that you're going to be raising some funds for. I mean, we need live venues, don't we?
We do.
acts such as a Hive Society established. So why are they important in your lives then? I know you played here at the latest music bar.
I think not just for playing, but also just going to gigs, yeah. Like just before lockdown
music
started.
Is like the, I mean, I would be tempted to say the most important kind of cultural facet in the country. You know, music is I don't know, it's everywhere. the country needs live music venues.
Yeah.
People need to be able to listen to live music. And the music industry as a whole wouldn't exist without live performances, especially in this day and age when you don't make any money off recordings anyway.
No.
So bands and artists survive through playing live.
Especially at a grassroots level.
Even more so.
Because otherwise you won't get new acts like us being able to develop and build a fan base.
Yeah, you're a good example of why we need live music venues. So, I mean, what do you think the future holds for the music industry? We were talking off stage about live streaming. There's a role to play there. It's live gigs, isn't it, really?
Yeah, I think it's, we're talking about this 1.57 billion that's just been announced today. Although that is really exciting, obviously we don't know how that money is going to get filtered through the system, because that is for the arts in general. It's still, even after that, it's still unclear as to what the future is. But I don't think personally that live streaming is going to be as exciting as like actually going to a gig.
I think it's still important. Grassroots venues still need support. Even like this 1.57 billion, is great and everything, but God knows how that's going to be spent.
Yeah.
And it's for the arts in general, which is obviously great, but I don't think it...
Okay, good luck with your gig. We'll
thank
catch up again soon.
Thank
and
you.
Thanks for coming, Rasheem, Finn and we've got Jasper as well and...
Noah.
And Noah, so the rest of the band. So all the best, guys.
Cheers.
Thank you for having us.
Thank you.